So most people that know me know that I am a little bit into superheroes. Okay, I'm lying. I am totally a huge bit into superheroes. But I mean, as a superhero scientist, I have found my home in the Comic-Con community. Where else can you combine your love of all things super with fabrication skills? So I have some pretty strict criteria for who I decide to cosplay. The truth is, the character or their storyline has to resonate with me. And if I can get a redhead in the mix, I'm all for it. So after taking a year off from cosplays, I think I'm finally ready to jump back in. But in a world that's been so out of control and full of loss, who could possibly be resonating with me right now? Of course, Wanda. The powers, the wardrobes, the bling. And speaking of the bling, I know exactly what maker we need to bring on board for this. If you're in Southern California and you want to design and build superhero tech, there's no better place to go than Matterhackers. Matterhackers is the largest 3D printing shop in the US that's on a mission to make 3D printing easier and more accessible for everyone.
Hey, welcome to Matterhackers. My name is Dylan Wolf. I'm the creative manager here, and I'd love to show you guys around. So this is our warehouse. It's huge. And right here is going to be our creative studio.
Wow, look at this. Hey. It's us. You're up.
So this is where we create all of the content for Matterhackers, from our YouTube videos to all of our photos for the website, all of our social media images. Everything comes out of this room right here. And this is one of our resin stations here with our ultrasonic cleaner.
I like the glowing filament.
A lot of our build series resin is UV sensitive, so it glows right like that under the blue and black lights.
That.
Yeah,
so this is a
fully 3D printed engine block that comes apart, lets you peek inside.
My very first tinkering was rebuilding engines with my dad, so like this kind of stuff just makes me super happy. While most people associate 3D printing with toys, there's actually a lot of functionality that comes out of it. So for instance, you have like a lacrosse head that you can 3D print, a cell phone cover, Batman cookie cutters. I mean, who doesn't want that in their life? And then my personal favorite, that Phenom wrench. This is, no, they're the same size. They're both wrenches. This is super cool. When I start looking at designing a cosplay, I look at all the images that are available to me of that character. So whether it's comics or TV series or movies, I want to kind of look at everything and figure out which outfit and which props I think would be a fun challenge to build. So with Wanda, AKA the Scarlet Witch, we have a ton of options. We have the classic Wanda where she's in the unitard and the tights, or we can backflash to the actual Marvel Cinematic Universe and we see her in the corsets with the draper jackets and the pants and the boots. But now we have this bad version of her outfit at the end of WandaVision. The best part is her new crown. Now this thing is gorgeous. So if I'm going to start anywhere with this cosplay, it's gonna be that bling. But even with all of this amazing technology, I cannot start this cosplay without a maker friend at my side. And when you're in 3D printing and you wanna become a hero, there is only one man to call. No, not Optimus Prime, no, get out of here, no. You gotta call Daryl, AKA the Broken Nerd. Daryl is one of the most talented 3D modeler and printers I've met in the 3D printing world. He has made drool-worthy renditions of some of the most sought-after and intricate designs ranging throughout all fandoms, including, but surely not limited to, Gamora's Switchblade, Suri's helmet from Black Panther, Wonder Woman's tiara, and an Infinity Gauntlet that would make even the nicest person want to snap. Literally. Makers assemble!
Oh, okay. Yeah, Tamara, that's loud enough. We got you.
I always wanted to do that.
Hey everyone, this is Daryl. I am a 3D modeler and prop maker and YouTuber as well. And I just enjoy making props, 3D modeling and 3D printing props from various genres.
So obviously you've watched WandaVision. Like, what are your thoughts on this new look that we get from Wanda at the end of the series?
It looks amazing. That's what kind of prompted me to model the crown. I haven't modeled a lot of crowns or tiaras, so this one was kind of a no-brainer. The design was just amazing, and it was an interesting model to tackle. It was fun, and I do like the design.
So Daryl, when you're choosing to build a prop, how do you decide what makes the cut? Like, what's your criteria for the props that you want to model out and design and build?
I tend to try and do things that people haven't done before. Like the Iron Man helmet is oversaturated. Unless I want it in my collection, I'll do it. But outside of that, I just kind of tend to pick things that catch my eye at the end of the day. Something that looks cool. Like one of the things I obsess over is the Infinity Gauntlet. And not a lot of people have modeled or printed it. So yeah, it's really comes down to what catches my eye.
So a lot of the times the props that you're building, you're putting out before the series or the movie is even available for you to take home. So what does that process look like?
I'll start off with trying to find reference material online. If I can get views of the front, back, inside, or where I can put into the program and use that as my basis, then that works even better. But sometimes something as new as like the Wanda crown did not have like the front and side. It just had some weird angles. But I'm not the one for trying to get something 100% accurate, because things tend to look bigger on screen than they really are. I try to pull measurements to kind of get it to the proper size that it is.
When you're designing and printing a piece, how do you decide which of your printers you're going to use for that exact prop?
Kind of comes down to the model and how much detail it has. Over the last year or so now, I've been mostly printing in resin. Part of it is because the amount of detail that you're able to capture, and the cleanup on it is so much easier and faster. So I pretty much converted over to resin printing. I do have a few FDM printers I use for other things, for lightweight material, something that I need to test print before I put it on the resin printer. I'll use the FDM printers.
Hey, I think I need to explain this real quick. So fused deposition modeling, or FDM, and stereolithography apparatus, or SLA, are just the two most popular types of 3D printers on the market. The most common technology used at the consumer level for 3D printing is FDM, which is where a strand of material, in this case a thermoplastic, is deposited in layers to create a 3D printed object. Now, the earliest form of UV curable 3D printing, and the most popular among professionals, is SLA. Like FDM, SLA is an additive method, with the model being built layer by layer. However, SLA uses a UV laser to draw layer by layer on a curable photopolymer, typically a liquid resin. SLA printers consistently produce high resolution objects with better accuracy than FDM printers, because the resolution is primarily determined by the optical spot size of the laser versus the nozzle size. Thus, with the elaborate detailing of Wanda's crown, SLA is the perfect fit for our build. So okay, let's go get back to it.
To construct Wanda's crown today, we're going to be using the Peopoly Phenom MSLA 3D printer. Now, this is a resin-based system, so Daryl's walked me through the benefits of utilizing this for the crown, and one of the things that I'm really excited about is we're going to get really good detailing on this, which, if you've seen WandaVision, you know that crown is very delicate and intricate, so I cannot wait to see the details that this printer enables. Let's take a look inside. So as you can see, there's a vat of resin in the Peopoly Phenom. And what we're gonna be using for our building materials today is actually the Matterhackers MH Build resin line. This is gonna be our 3D printing photopolymer resin that's gonna enable us to have an intricate, detailed, and efficiently made crown. All of the chaos magic is on this little stick. So the beautiful modeling that Daryl has done for Wanda's crown, and then the support systems that we're gonna need, are all in here. But now, we gotta get it in the Peopoly Phenom.
So we're gonna do a little docking. Oh, look at that, the light. The light's a good sign. That means things are happening. Things are going on.
This is super user friendly. So now we're just gonna come over here. We're gonna push the print button. We're gonna go through. We're not doing the fantasy castle or the knurled nuts. I go down to my file labeled Wanda Crown Textured, click on it, confirming that it's the textured version with the supports, I just push play. And we are off to the races, y'all. Now, just because the crown is done printing, it doesn't mean it's completely finished. It still needs to be cleaned and cured. So, I enlisted the help of Taylor Landry, Director of R&D at Matterhackers, to show me how it's done.
When you remove the part from the printer, there's still resin, uncured resin on the part. So we need to get that off, and we're gonna put it in a bath ultrasonic cleaner with some resin solvent. Turn that on. So now we're going to wash it in some warm soapy water to make sure that all of uncured resin is completely off and we don't have any resin cleaner residue left on the surface anywhere. And these supports, we're gonna fully remove them before we do the post-curing, because as you can see, this is still pretty flexible. And after the post-curing and the UV, it will become a lot stiffer. So the supports will be harder to remove and also more likely to crack or break the part. I think it's pretty good. So now we're gonna just rinse this off to get the soap off, and we'll put it in the UV cure. So this is a cure box. As you can see, there's different options, standard, flexible, tough, castable, and then custom. Different resins do have different post-cure operations. To achieve the maximum tensile strength, for example, you would need to cure certain resins in a certain way. In this case, obviously strength is not an issue. We just wanna make sure it's fully cured. So we're just gonna do a 5 minute UV cure with no heat and run. You can see the
lights are on.
So this looks and feels a full cure. So you can see if I hold it, it's not flopping around like it was.
It's like much harder.
Yeah.
This is nice. This detailing is so cool. And I like how you don't actually have the print lines you have in 3D printing. Like that's
Yeah, you actually do. It's just much harder to see. There are some things, if you know what you're looking for, to tell it that it was 3D printed.
You can actually, so you know what a voxel is?
Mm-hmm.
Some of this is due to that because machines only have pixels on the LCD. So it's a square. And imagine if you're trying to make a round edge with just squares. If you were to look under this on a microscope, you probably would, it would look a lot, it would look jagged. Because it's so small, it still looks and feels to the naked eye fairly smooth. It gives it a different surface quality than an FDM would.
Hey, I think I need to explain this real quick. Voxel isn't a secret code or anything. In fact, it's a pretty simple idea. While its long-form volumetric picture element sounds complex, for all intents and purposes, a voxel is just a three-dimensional pixel, or the tiniest distinguishable element of a 3D object. For instance, Lego blocks are voxels. They have a defined shape and size and can be stacked on each other to ultimately make a new object. See, there's no mandatory size or shape for a voxel. All that's required is that when it is regularly repeated, it combines to form an object that is more precise than the fabricator that created it. Going back to our Lego example, what this means is a child playing with these blocks needs an accuracy of roughly 1 millimeter hand placement to assemble them. But the final Lego block structure will actually have an accuracy of up to 5 nanometers. This works because the geometric structure of a voxel makes it so they self-align as long as they're placed in the right direction. Therefore, the precision of the final part depends solely on the tolerance of the voxel, or in this case, the Lego block. Pretty simple, huh? Okay, let's go get back to it.
Carol did a phenomenal job modeling this, and the Peopoly Phenom did an incredible job printing it. So this is just a beautiful piece. I think it's time to put it on. It fits. Now, if only I had Vision around to help with the rest of the outfit. I think I'm ready.
So there's something I like to do to celebrate the end of every episode with my guests, but we're gonna need higher ceilings than this. So let's go this way. You tell me when you're ready. And 3, 2, 1. And as you can see, we have super high ceilings, we have safety glasses, and we have a fire extinguisher very closely nearby. So don't do this at home. Unless you're with me, then do it. Hey everyone, I'm super excited to announce I've teamed up with the awesome team of folks at Matterhackers to dive into the science of resin printing. And to celebrate, we will be giving away the same type of materials we're using in the episode, the Peopoly Phenom and the MH Build Resin. So make sure to go to the link below and sign up today. We'll announce the winner on the next episode of Maker Science, so make sure you've subscribed to the Midnight Science Club and ring the bell so you'll be notified when the next episode comes out. If you want to see more awesome 3D printing tech, be sure to subscribe to The Broken Nerd and Matter Hackers, and you can stay up to date on the latest announcements and all the behind-the-scenes Maker Science fun by following the Midnight Science Club and me on social media, YouTube, and of course, Patreon. Oh, come here. Don't sulk. We're still friends.